Hello, everybody. I'm Jeff Moss, owner of College Hunks Hauling Junk and College Hunks Moving in Wilmington, North Carolina and Griffin, Georgia. It's my pleasure to do these interviews with people that I respect, old friends, CEOs, people that have had a lot of things going in their life and achieved greatly. Today's no exception. My guest today is Luke Esslinger. So Luke and I have known each other for over 20 years. And Luke, I'm just going to throw the ball to you and tell everybody how you and I know one another.
Boy, that's it's going to be hard to do without laughing, I think. But I guess it is over 20 years ago out in New York with Pfizer Pharmaceuticals and the training department. And I never thought I'd meet someone that could have as much fun at work as I could. And I'd like to say I'll leave it at that. But boy, we really had some good times. Some of the practical jokes that you would do, and I would just shake my head thinking, I'm not sure if this is going to get us fired, but it sure is fun.
Some of them probably should have.
Yes, indeed.
Or at least chastised anyway.
For sure.
Well, Luke and I go way back. We actually were working at the Doral Arrowwood, which was Pfizer's National Training Center in Rye, New York, which is one of the nicest areas of New York. Neither one of us could afford to live in Rye, so we lived in a little town called Brewster, New York. And we would commute to work together with several other people. It was all about trying to save fuel, not on purpose, but just mainly because of the expense, and get to work. We'd go home. But I think one of my fondest memories is going to work out every morning. And Camille still gives me grief that I really didn't work out. I just drank coffee and chatted while you guys pumped the iron, right?
Hey, as long as you show up at the gym, what you do there really doesn't matter.
No, I was there lending moral support.
And we appreciate that.
So over the course of our time as national trainers for Pfizer, yes, Luke and I engaged in some practical jokes, and we'll probably talk a little bit about those during the course of this. But we were also there when Pfizer built a state-of-the-art learning center and had the privilege of teaching a first class in that state-of-the-art learning center. The whole point of being there was to develop and then move on in our careers, which Luke and I both did. And then, unfortunately, both of us went through a lot of downsizing and things like that during the pharmaceutical career. But Luke and I are going to talk a little bit about a number of things in terms of leadership and resilience, how to bounce back through tough times. But when Luke and his wife, Amy, came into our lives, my wife, Camille, and I, we had two young children, Mallory and Jay, and Mallory had a severe medical illness. She had intractable epilepsy. Luke and Amy at that point did not have children, so they were beside us in probably one of the toughest times in my life, and I'm just going to start there, man. How did you and Amy feel as you experienced Camille and I going through this really difficult challenge?
Honestly, we couldn't grasp how you guys did it with such grace. I mean, you just had a level of confidence and belief that seemed hard to grasp, but it was contagious. You know, I would hear you guys talk about all the praying you did on what you should do for some of the medical decisions for just a horrendous situation that no parent should have to deal with. And you both handled it with such confidence, like, okay, this is what we're going to do. This is what we believe is the right choice. And every decision you made clearly was the right choice. Some of the stories that you have shared during that process back then, I've heard you talk about them again. It'll break your heart, and it'll also bring tears to your eyes of just the excitement of just having the opportunity to be around medical experts that could do what they did for Mallory. And it was awe-inspiring to see that. And I know you've said before, you know, it was preparation for you to prepare for things that we'd have to deal with. And I think you're right. I think everything happens for a reason. Sometimes it doesn't make sense what that reason might be until years pass. But it was an unbelievable experience. And I don't think anyone can understand it unless they live through it right there with you. And we were fortunate to have that opportunity to be there with you.
So we're both of the Christian faith, and it's no secret. I never tried to hide my faith at all. I'm always open to talk about it. Luke and Amy actually went to church with us at the little United Methodist Church there in Brewster, New York. And as we were going through the trials and tribulations of Mallory's illness, and frankly, had to face brain surgery, it really, put a lot of stress on us and our family, but having friends like Luke and Amy in our lives to support us through it. But little did we know, Luke and Amy not having children, that their experience of being a witness to what Camille and I had to deal with would really come to bear in their personal lives down the road. And we'll get into that a little bit. But Luke, so when you left the Pfizer Learning Center, I mean, primarily we were talking about some of the things we did. I'm just going to go ahead and lay one of them out there. We had a lady that worked with us, and she was always on edge. When we moved into the new learning center, we had these file cabinets that would roll out from under the desk, and they were on rollers. So one day Luke and I pulled her file cabinet out and reversed it and slid it back under the desk drawers first. And what was like 15 minutes after we'd done it, we heard somebody screaming from their office. Oh my God. I had drawers. My drawers.
With that thick New York accent. It was, I just about fell to the ground when I was laughing so hard.
I think one of the funniest pranks I pulled on you was hiding under your desk. And I must have had to stay there 30 minutes because I didn't know when you were going to come back to your office. So I got under Luke's desk, and he got in there and started working and got all comfortable. And when I felt the moment was right, I reached out and grabbed him by both ankles and screamed at the top of my lungs. He came over backwards out of his chair. Anyway, we digress.
I have no idea how we're friends after all of this.
It was fun, and it never stopped in my career. Part of building a really strong, coherent team is, having fun together. And I'll tell you right off the bat, one of the hallmark core values of our business, College Hunks, is to create a fun, enthusiastic team environment. And I mean, it's such a perfect fit for me because I love having fun and I love laughing and I love watching people grow into great leaders. So we were in our leadership development moment there in New York, and both went on to become district managers for this major pharmaceutical company. And then over time, I mean, your story kind of started changing. Talk a little bit about, the downsizing and then how your career had to shift paths. And I believe you got into wound management, right?
I did, yeah. So it was interesting. The there was constant downsizing, and it wasn't just Pfizer; it was the entire pharmaceutical industry. Yep. Constant downsizing, and I was a district manager with another gentleman, and that shared the same geography, just with a different district, or different division, I should say. His name was Tracy Lucas, and we became very good friends. They lived about a mile from us. They had kids same age as ours, so we really developed pretty good friendship personally. And then professionally, we were with each other constantly. And over time, throughout all of these reductions in the sales force and in the management side, we finally got to a point we knew one of us was going to be out. And We didn't know which one it was going to be. I don't even quite remember which way I wanted it to be, because it was just an emotional roller coaster. And I can remember I got the call that I was going to be retained, which meant Tracy was not. So Tracy was out, and he immediately got a job in the skin substitute world.
Okay.
And landed the job immediately. And I stayed with Pfizer, and I can still remember. And I mean, that's 17 years in the pharmaceutical industry, the bulk of that on the management side. It was great. I mean, I have amazing memories. I learned more from that industry than I could probably learn from any other job I could have had. But it changed a lot, especially those last 5 years. And those last 5 years, it just wasn't the same for me, at least. and I didn't have the same job satisfaction with it. And I can still remember going over to Tracy's house the day we both got the call that he's out and I'm retained. And I thought, well, this is good. I have the job security. And I went over to his house because I had to grab a bunch of his stuff on reps that he had that I was going to be inheriting. And I remember sitting in his kitchen and his wife was there as well. And I'm thinking, I don't think I got the better end of this deal. It was such an emotional roller coaster because that morning I was so relieved that I had the job just from a security standpoint. I had two young kids. I thought, you know, life isn't bad. I don't love my job anymore, but I have the security. So, and then I went to his house and I remember walking out his front door. I mean, it was so emotional. I remember almost thinking like I could literally burst down crying right now.
Yeah.
Thinking he won. He got his severance package and I didn't.
And they were big back then.
They were good severance.
They were robust. Packages. Yeah.
And it was about a minute drive home and it felt like 10 years to get home. And I was just so depressed thinking, mm-hmm. Well, this is my life. This is what I'm going to be doing now. And he moved on, and for, I don't know, must have been about a year, I continued doing it. And I remember telling my wife, Amy, that I'm miserable. I don't like my job anymore, and I need to get out. So I spent about 6 months trying to basically get out. And I found an opportunity that got me closer to home in Wisconsin. I lived in Iowa at the time. My parents obviously they're still fortunately both alive, but you know, getting up there in age. So I thought it'd be nice to get back to the parents and get so they can have more time with the grandkids, and took a job and completely out of the medical world. And I was a manager for a marketing company basically, and did that and kept in touch with Tracy, and he was incredibly successful. He was the number one rep in the country for this skin graft company. And he kept on telling me, it's phenomenal. Hmm. Had record sales. Like I think every other month we set a new record with this company that I was with. Felt like, okay, things are going pretty well. They're getting record sales. I'm at a meeting at about 7:30 in the morning, and I get a call from my wife, and she said, Adam has lost all use of the, at this point, he was 9 years old, had lost use of everything in his legs. He couldn't walk. He was completely paralyzed from the legs down.
So does he wake up and he suddenly just can't get out of bed? I mean, what?
My wife heard him screaming from his room because he had tried to get out of bed and had no use of his legs.
Oh, my mercy.
So she went in and he just was obviously in a panic. So they raced him off to Children's Hospital in Milwaukee. I ran out of the meeting and raced to meet her there, pulled into the parking lot at the same time. And by the time in that 20 minutes to get to the hospital, he had lost a lot of the use of his arms, minimal use of his arms. So I scooped him up and we raced into Children's Hospital and the ER, and one person after another came in, and they eventually had a neurologist come in to evaluate him. And by this point, he couldn't use his arms anymore. He could only move his head. He could rotate his neck around. That was about it. And this all transpired like in an hour at the hospital. I'm like, well, that's, you know, this clearly is not right. So,
and Kayla's how old at this time, your daughter?
Kayla would have been probably 6 or 7, about 6 or 7 years old.
This okay. Time.
And so the neurologist said, hey, step on out to the hallway. Adam was crying in the room because he can't move other than his head. And we said, we'll be right back. And the neurologist just rattled it off real quick. I mean, it was like a machine gun going off, just saying, we think it's Guillain-Barré, it's a autoimmune disorder, and we need to get him up to ICU. He's going to continue to become more and more paralyzed, and we got to get him ready for life support. Mm. I looked at Amy and I said, put on a smiling face because we can't have him scared. And we walked back into the hospital room and up he went to ICU. Never saw so many machines in my life. You obviously had that experience with Mallory. You don't understand how you can have eight medical professionals literally hovering over one little bed and machines coming out from the ceiling, walls. I mean, it was unreal. And it was a surreal moment because I can remember the chief of ICU, you know, grabbed us, pulled us out into the hallway, and he said, well, we're going to get him hooked up and get everything ready so he doesn't get any worse. And at this point, I'm in this anger mode, like, get worse? Like, what are you talking about? He's at this point, all he can do is blink. He's lost all muscle that he can control other than he can blink. And I said, you know, he's getting worse and worse. All he can do is blink. What do you mean get worse? And he just in the most calm voice, matter of fact, he goes, yep, and the next two things that will go are his lungs and his heart, and we're going to have the machines here to keep him alive until we can solve this. So that's why he's here, so we keep him alive.
So did that ever happen? Did he ever lose?
No, unfortunately, he didn't. It was quite a gift that didn't happen, but it was obviously a horrendous experience. And so he spent almost 2 months in the hospital. Took him a year after he got released before he could walk again. Had to learn how to swallow, how to talk, how to pick up a pencil. I mean, 9 years old, he couldn't do anything. Shortly after that, I went into work with this company that I've been, you know, new level management for them, and owner of the company pulled me in the office in the morning right when I got there and said, hey, just want you to know we've made a decision and it has nothing to do with insurance. But we're going to be moving on from you.
Nothing to do with insurance.
That was the only thing I could remember him saying because I was so stunned. I'm like.
And the only thing that's changed is your son got deathly sick and you had to go see to his needs.
Yeah. Yeah. But then I think I took a week off. I took a week off. He was in the hospital for 2 months. And I would just go there every day after work and see him in the hospital. And then in the week, Amy would sleep there. And then the weekends, she would sleep at home so she could have more time with our daughter. And then I would sleep at the hospital. So I got let go for reasons that the owner of that company can live with that for the rest of his life. And I hope he struggles sleeping. And I'm sure he does. I had an opportunity to get in with the same company that Tracy Lucas was at, and the skin graft company. And I think he had like 2 years in a row where he was the number one rep in the country. And I thought, well, whatever you're doing, I need to mirror. Yeah. So got me in wound care. And we were both in wound care. We both loved it. And we eventually, and I'm sure this is probably going too long and I apologize, but.
Oh, it's all right. It's your story, man. Tell it.
So I've had people say, well, how did you guys start this company?
Paul's right there for a second. I want all the listeners and people watching this to know that there is light at the end of the tunnel, first of all. Adam is a senior in college now.
Yes.
Adam can walk and run.
100%.
100% recovered, and he's okay. So let's just put that
thank
out.
Thank you. Thank you.
I know everybody's sitting there going, okay, what happened? So with my daughter, Mallory was debilitated from 2 rounds of major brain surgery, and she's special needs and will live with her mother and I for the rest of her life until we can no longer care for her. And fortunately, her little brother is poised to take care of her. The good news is her seizures are pretty well under control and she can run a microwave oven. She can stay by herself. We never leave her overnight, but she's self-reliant. So if there's a blessing in that, we have a blessing in it. But I could never, I guess in terms of coming, and I can't believe I haven't already broken down and started crying. Everybody that knows me well is probably shocked that I'm not babbling here and I can't explain it, but I think God wants me to get through this. When things are happening in your life like this and you have to make a conscious decision to run to God or run from God, run to your spouse or run from your spouse, what Camille and I had to come to terms with is there's a reason things happen. Sometimes they're inexplicable. Sometimes you shouldn't even try to find a reason for it. But in looking back on the parallels of our story, I know, and I believe in my heart, that God put you and Amy in our life at that moment so you would be ready for what was to come. I don't think God causes these things to happen, but God, being all-knowing, recognizes that they will happen. I mean, do you agree with that, that God has a plan?
100% agree. Yeah, 100%. It does all happen for a reason. And, you know, being there with you, with what you and Camille were dealing with Mallory, and also just, you know, watching how Jay, I it's funny, I still refer to him as Jay Bird.
Yeah. We do too. He's our Jay Bird.
I was going to say, hopefully that's not offensive to him now that he's a big dog in the military, but yeah. He's still Jay Bird to me. But think about what you just said, like, when you and Camille can't take care of Mallory anymore, Jay will.
Oh, yeah.
And the bride will, right? So that says a lot about how you raised him.
He's got impeccable character, and he married well. My daughter-in-law, she lost her mother early in life as a teenager. Her mother, unfortunately, passed due to breast cancer. And she helped her dad raise her three little sisters. Now, let me tell you, any man that can raise four daughters, I should do one of these calls with him. He remarried just a few years ago, but he raised four little girls, and one of them was a baby, and Mary. And, you know, it's just amazing. So Katie started kind of parenting at about 14 years of age, and she got up one morning for coffee with me and asked me what keeps me up at night. And I was honest with her, and I told her, you know, what happens to Mallory after we're gone. And she basically, this was before she and Jay got married. They were engaged. And she said, you don't need to lose another minute of sleep over that. We've got her. Don't worry. And see, that'll get me emotional. So, oh, what a relief that God puts these incredible people in your life. None of this has anything to do with Leadership 101, but actually it does, because servant leadership was part of what God, through his son, Jesus Christ, showed those of us of faith, that this is how the servant leader model works. You take care of your people. And in your instance, instead of taking care of you, you were essentially cast aside at a moment where you didn't need one more thing on your plate. But where I want to go with that is what you did with it. So easily, my son's in the hospital, because Adam was still in the hospital when you got let go, right?
Oh yeah, for like another month afterwards, I believe.
So with being let go, your insurance now dissipates. It's gone.
Living on Cobra, yes.
Wow. And then, you know, he gets out of the hospital. But folks, this is where the story gets really great, because I will tell you, Luke is 49 years old, and he just sold the business he and his partner developed. And Luke is now deciding beyond travel, what his next move is going to be, because Luke built an incredible company. So talk a little bit about how you get Adam out of the hospital, and then how you bridge into building a business and being an entrepreneur, and frankly, never letting somebody have that much control over your life again. Talk about that.
Yeah. So it started long before Adam was ever sick. And it's funny to think about what triggered all of this, but when we lived in Iowa, I was going out to my mailbox, and my mailbox was basically right next to my neighbor's mailbox. And my neighbor Bob was walking by, and I was small talk with him, because he had another house that he would, you know, own and leased out, or rented out, I should say. And I'm like, how'd you get into property management? And he goes, read this book. You got to read it. It's unbelievable. It'll change your life. And I'm like, okay, I'm willing to change my life. He goes, there's an old book. It's called Rich Dad, Poor Dad. So I read Rich Dad, Poor Dad, and was obsessed with it. And there's like six versions of it. And I think in a 2-month time frame, I read every single one of them, probably a couple times. And at that point, I'm like, I'm going to be an entrepreneur. Like, I don't mind working for people, but I can tell you right now, I'm going to like working for myself a lot more.
And how old were you when that happened, when you read Rich Dad, Poor Dad?
This would have probably been right around late 30s, 37 maybe.
Okay.
And absolutely was obsessed with it and talked to my good friend and colleague, Tracy Lucas, about it. And we decided we have to start a business. So we looked at, you know, do we do a duplex? Do we do quads? We looked at doing the digital billboards. We got to the point we were going to do a pig farm. Now, we don't know anything about farming. And if you knew Tracy Lucas,
I'm glad you didn't do that. That was a good call not to do the pig farm. I can tell you that.
I'll tell you, we signed the contract to do it, which is basically you're just going to front the money so they can build the farm and then other people do it. And then every 6 months, new piglets come in and they take the old ones out, right?
Yeah.
So we signed the contract, and a week after we signed it, we're like, hey, we're owners of a business here. We're going to be pig farmers. Well, the price of, you know, concrete like tripled, some national shortage. And they said, hey, it's going to change the contract. And we said, well, we won't do that, but we at least want a free pound of bacon out of this deal. So I got a free pound of bacon after owning a pig farm in my head for a week.
So once again, God works in mysterious ways.
Yes, he does. Go up
and he closed the door before it actually opened for me.
Yes, he did. So we're now, Tracy and I are both in the skin graft company. This is after I was let go, got into the same company he was with. We were both sales reps, loved it. And a couple of his good doctors and friends of his were telling him, hey, you guys like this business, you should get into this wound care supply DME world and provide dressing, shipping directly to the patient's house, because most of the companies out there are just horrendous. Well, Tracy had two doctors in a two-day difference bring this concept up. It's like, well, we have to look at this. So Tracy and I kind of explored it. One thing led to another. We said, let's go for it. I talked it over with my wife. She's like, hey, whatever you want to do, do. If it makes you happy, go for it. Don't worry about it. So I'm like, all right, well, let's go for this.
A good wife would.
Yes. Yeah. I was fortunate. Very fortunate. Yeah. So yeah, there was no hesitation from her at all. So long story short, in about 4 or 5 years, we built it to be the third largest in the world. And we were very fortunate. A lot of growing pains. We were clueless on what we were doing. We'd never done a business before. So we learned a lot of hard lessons, but a lot of success. And
all right. So let me just recap what I think I just heard. Your son's in the hospital 2 months. At the end of the first month, you're basically told, sorry, this has nothing to do with insurance, but there's the door.
Yep.
You walk out, get into the wound care business, selling with Tracy. And then how long did it take you to build the world's third largest wound care supply company after that?
So in 2014, we started the business, and it was just on paper. It took us 13 months to get through all of the Medicare paperwork and approvals. And that from that point on, about 3.5-4 years into it, we were the third largest.
See, that's folks. So what you're hearing here is resilience. You're hearing daring to dream. You're hearing putting together a business plan that took 13 months to go from start to finish. You're hearing absolute refusal to fail. And you also just heard the third largest wound care supply company in the world, which Luke has sold, and at 49 years of age is doing a call with me on Leadership 101.
Life is good, man. Life is good.
I am so, well, you know, personally, Luke, I am so happy. This could not have happened to a better person. I am so proud that you're my friend. And what I haven't talked about during the call is you and I talked. I mean, over these 18 or years or so, we've been constantly on the phone, and I have been a witness to all this happen. I remember when you called me during the period that you guys were building the business plan, telling me about all the red tape you were having to go through just to get paid through the system, through Medicare particularly. And over this period of time, you put on sales reps, you had salespeople in almost every state. In fact, I think I tried to resource a couple of people for you through the years. And the only regret I had is that you and Tracy didn't call me and go, hey, hey, Moss Dog. But God has a plan, and now I own a moving and hauling company in two locations, two states. So life is good, man, and you're right. So I sit here and I hear these stories, and I want to just go back and highlight a couple of things about how things have changed. So when Mallory first got sick, she was perfectly normal till 5. Adam was perfectly normal until 9. Mallory had her first seizure just before her 6th birthday. At that point, I'm working for Pfizer. She had a seizure, and then 2 weeks went by, and then she had another one. Like you, I'm at a national sales meeting in Florida and get a note to call home, and she's had another ambulance ride to the hospital due to another major seizure. And I came home, and I'm telling you, life kind of started coming apart at that point because it's unexpected. You're living life. I tell people that when you see a family pushing a wheelchair with a child in it that's obviously having issues, your heart breaks for them. And then the next thing you know, you're the parent behind the wheelchair and you're wondering, how did I get here? What happened? And it happened so fast for both of us. But Mallory's in the hospital at Emory University, and she's been there, and this is in Atlanta. She's been there for probably 2 weeks getting evaluated because now we're in a serious problem. She went from one seizure to another seizure 2 weeks later to hundreds of seizures a day. So she can't eat. She's losing function, bodily fluid function. You know, it's terrible. And I will never forget this day. And I still text, well, sometimes call this man, gentleman named John Strange. He was my regional manager at Pfizer. And on a Sunday morning, John came walking into Mallory's hospital room. And she had, you know, EEG monitors on her head, wires coming off everywhere. And John just kind of peeked in and he gave me the, come here for a minute. We stepped out in the hall and he said, what's the prognosis? What's going on? So I read him in. And then I looked at him, Luke, and I said, John, I don't know what to do. He said, what do you mean? I said, well, I'm kind of new with the company. I've got 3 weeks vacation. I've already burned two of it here in the hospital with her. I'm going to run out of time. And I don't know what to do. And John looked at me. Now, this was a long time ago. I'm talking 25 years ago. John looked at me, Luke, and he said, you call this a vacation? Son, I call this hell on earth. When you can go back to work, you tell me. But until then, your place of business and duty is here in this hospital with your child. And man, that turned me into the bluest blooded Pfizer rep probably in the history of the company, because what he did for me contrasted with what happened to you was night and day. And I will tell you, and you were witness to this, years later, you know, we finally got Mallory out of the hospital, got some basic control of her seizures, but I'm up in New York when she has to have the brain surgeries, and I had no less of a different experience there. We were in the hospital in Hackensack, New Jersey. The Pfizer Learning Center was in Rye, and I was basically told by Pfizer senior leadership that my job was to take care of my daughter. They knew what I was going through, and then they jumped through hoops to get us relocated back down to Georgia. They took such incredible care of me. And back in those days, Pfizer spelled P-F-I-Z-E-R, and the P-F, we also had something called the Pfizer family, as you recall. But you know what I've witnessed after that, and as the years went down? That attitude toward employees and family, I don't care what company you're working for, what you're doing, vamoosed. Never. You know, I had a rep at one point, one mine, but I know her daughter was in a wreck and broke both legs. And I was at headquarters in Atlanta arguing that mother needed to be with her daughter and what are we doing? And all I was hearing was Family Medical Leave Act and all this kind of thing. And, oh, she and her dad. And I'm like, you know, she's a teenage girl. Her dad can't help her with her needs. I mean, I just can't imagine. But man, things have changed through the years with regard to how companies approach people that are having severe trauma in their lives like this. The Family Medical Leave Act came in. It was basically, hey, take the time you need and we'll hold your job. Well, who can afford that? You know, who can afford to take that much time off work? I will tell you that I had one of my guys break his leg back over Christmas, and he was one of my salaried employees. And it felt good for me to say, dude, get well. We got you. We're not going to stop paying you. Don't worry. We're such a small business. You know, I wish we had more that we could do. But regardless, you know, my experience changed me as a human being. And I was a loyal, dedicated employee because of the way I was treated.
You know, Jeff, hearing your story, and I think anyone that works for companies for multiple years with larger companies has stories as positive as that, and yeah, some that would be complete opposite, where it's horrendous, right?
Yeah.
That to me, and I think this is why how Tracy and I tried to approach how we wanted our business to be, everything you liked about your experiences, that one gentleman that said, this is not vacation, this is hell on earth. How many years have passed and you're still thinking of that story and the impact that has on you personally and professionally, right? I mean, now you have someone, I'm not saying a broken leg is not significant. No one wants a broken leg on a scale of where Mallory was compared to a broken leg, but yet you are approaching it with that same compassion. And it is those experiences you have, good, but also the bad, like, well, I know how I felt when this person did this to me, or I witnessed them treat another employee like that. I will never do that. And that to me is how you develop some leadership, is you figure out what you want to replicate and what you want to make sure you never repeat.
I distinctly recall another, and when we were having to relocate, you know, back down to Georgia so we could get help from our family, when Mallory had her first brain surgery, they removed most of her left frontal lobe. And it was, you know, she recovered pretty well from that one. It was a surgery a year later that really debilitated her. They had to separate her corpus callosum, which is a superhighway that connects the right and left hemispheres of the brain by 2/3. That debilitated her, slowed her down. She's developmentally delayed because of that. But when we're going through that, Pfizer's having a big debate at 235 East 42nd Street downtown. And word got back to me that from somebody that was in the meeting with human resources and with a couple of the presidents, vice presidents, that they were going to get me home, but I couldn't get a full reload package. I could only get a partial one, and this and that and the other. And the VP was pushing for the full deal under the circumstances. And HR said to him, well, you know, this is a precedent setting event. If we do this for Jeff, we're going to have to do it for another employee. And that VP, and I won't say his name, God rest his soul, he's no longer with us, but he looked at HR and said, the next time one of our great employees has a child having part of her brain removed, we'll do it again. How about that? How about that be the precedent? I didn't get the full moving package, but it meant so much to me that somebody would go to that degree to take care of my family. And we were able to get back to Georgia. I went back into a sales role for a few years while we rehabilitated Mallory, and then I was brought right back into management. I spent a lot of years as a district manager. I loved every minute of it when I could actually lead a team and make decisions for people. And, you know, it has its moments, as everything does. But, you know, Luke, there are people that are just born to lead. And from my days in the military till even now, I love talking to great leaders. I love learning from people. Somebody asked me the other day, what are you getting out of these leadership one-on-one deals? I'm like, an immense amount of knowledge. Every single person I'm talking to is giving me this gift of not only their time, but their knowledge. And if you seek to grow and seek to learn, you can pretty much do anything. So in closing, as you think about your next steps, it's got to be with excitement that at 49, you can take a break, do some traveling with your wife. And oh, by the way, she is an entrepreneur. What the name of her company is?
Yeah, no, she is. So she's 6 years in, Vintage Barn Chick. She does a home decor store with another, she's 50-50 partners with another woman, and has just been incredible success. So yeah, entrepreneurship, I guess, is in the family.
It is. So Vintage Barn Chicks is pretty cool. It's up in Wisconsin. And I would be remiss if I didn't say in our closing remarks too that you are one of the most rabid Green Bay Packers fans on the planet Earth. I love when the Green Bay Packers are on TV, Luke will not answer his telephone. So an ongoing 20 plus year practical joke is if I happen to turn on TV and I see the Green Bay Packers playing football, I call Luke and I know he's not going to answer. So I'll just let it ring and then hang up or leave him a voicemail. It's like, hey, man, I'm thinking about you. I hope the Pack wins today, unless it's against the Falcons, and then they still win. But regardless, I thought another thing, Luke, I want you to talk about before we close. One of the funniest stories you've ever told me is about your dad and McDonald's French fries. Tell everybody, I mean, this is the lineage. This is why Luke is such a driven person. When his dad takes a French fry this seriously, you can imagine why Luke built the third largest wound care supply company in the world in 3.5 years.
My dad is very particular. You are correct. So yeah, he has an obsession with hot food, and feels that anytime he goes to any restaurant, especially if it is fast food restaurant, he wants to have a detailed discussion of making sure that the French fries are, quote, hot out of the vat, so that it will burn the skin off the roof of my mouth. And he celebrates when that happens, which I find slightly disturbing. But yeah, he's very particular for sure.
Well, it was funny. I mean, you told me about the time he was at the McDonald's cashier and he's telling her that, and he goes, I want to make sure you understand. I want to stand over there and I want to watch that individual pull those fries out of the grease vat, put them in the package and come hand them directly to me where I will start consuming them. I can just visualize the employee behind the cash register hearing that and going, is this cat serious? And he was dead serious. Right?
Oh yeah, dead serious.
Well, if you had some parting comments, Luke, we've talked about resilience. We've talked about bouncing back. We talked about the grind, because I know it wasn't easy for you guys, you and Tracy, to build this company. But God, how gratifying it must be. And I know that you give all credit to God. You guys did the work, but God opened so many incredible doors in your life to do this, as he has with mine. Someday I'll have to share with you all the stuff that went on that got us into the green and orange, moving people, hauling their stuff. We like to say we move the things you love and get rid of the things you don't. And I'm so blessed to have had an opportunity to be part of this brand. But what are your parting thoughts for folks?
But I would say the greatest reason we had success for Tracy and I was surrounding ourselves with the right people. Tracy and I are complete opposites on many fronts, which was a gift. He opened my eyes to things on how to approach things that I just would have never thought of. And 9 out of 10 times he was right, and vice versa. I would often present different ways of viewing things. So that was a gift, making sure you get the right people on board, you know, people like you. I mean, the experience there, you've talked about how one of the keys to your success and what you're doing with College Hunks was just creating that standard operating procedure, right? Yeah. And you said you learned that from the military. Your experiences through the military are driving what you do right now, just like your experiences on how people are interacting with you regarding the health of your child, and it's influencing the decisions you make right now. You surround yourself with the right people, such as you, it's going to help you be successful. And that's what I think the key is.
Well, we're going to keep Adam and your family in our prayers. I am so thankful that the end of the story, which is he's just getting started, really, graduating from college. Yes. I can't wait to see what he does and what a story of resilience he has to tell at some point. So, yes. Folks, our guest today has been my good friend Luke Esslinger. Next up on Leadership 101 is Brad Caldwell. He's the owner of Spark Business Strategy. So if you're an entrepreneur and you're starting up a new business, Brad is going to give you a gift of knowledge in 30 minutes or less that is invaluable. He is one of the most brilliant marketers I know, and I've learned so much from him. And he has started a new t-shirt company, which I'm going to have a good time talking about. The name of it's Don't Tell My Mom. So that should give you an idea about the kinds of t-shirts he's marketing. But more than that, their first t-shirts are going to support a friend of ours that's been diagnosed with cancer. and their first profits are going to her to support her cancer struggle. So I'm looking forward to seeing Brad next time. Until then, for Leadership 101, I'm Jeff Moss. Have a blessed day.